Welcome to my program. Today we begin a new study in the book of Romans. This study takes us through the book of Romans, chapters 1 through 5. The title for this section is Salvation Needed. One name stands out above all others in the book of Romans. It is the name Jesus. The Apostle Paul describes himself as a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. As we see here, this name is usually coupled with others, such as Jesus Christ, or his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, or Son of God, or the Lord Jesus Christ. The name Jesus is generally thought of as being his earthly name. The word Christ means the Anointed One, the Messiah. The word Lord speaks to us of his administration of the universe, of his work in the lives of his people today, and of his ruling as King throughout all eternity. God's redemption is through Jesus Christ. The scripture just quoted shows us that God sent his Son, who is eternally God, into the world that he might become as a man, humble himself, and die the shameful death of the cross. It will help us to better understand God's plan of redemption in Christ if we grasp something of the significance of the name Jesus. Through him, we are told in the fifth verse, we have received grace and apostleship. This familiar word grace will mean more to us when we begin to comprehend the meaning of the name Jesus. That name literally spells out the fact of God being grace. The first two letters in Jesus, J, E, are found in the Old Testament name Jehovah. Now the word Jehovah is not a translation, but what is called a transliteration. The word in the original language, Hebrew in this case, was given English spelling without any attempt being made to give its meaning. It has, however, a very beautiful meaning, which was revealed to Moses. When he was sent to help the Israelites in Egypt, he was instructed by God to say, I am hath sent me. The words I am are mysterious until there is something added to complete the thought. The name Jesus means, I am your salvation. According to the first chapter of Matthew, he was called Jesus because he would save his people from their sins. The I am, however, means more than what the name Jesus implies. He is actually everything that we need. Whatever we lack, he is sufficient to supply that lack. The great theme in the book of Romans is salvation through Jesus. This now brings us to the word grace, for by Jesus we have received grace. To many people, grace is some sort of blessing that they are unable to define. In reality, it is an attribute of God. It is that part of God which governs his attitude toward man. It is in the heart of God to want to do something for someone who is in need. God created man with a need so that he could exercise his grace upon him. Grace, then, is God wanting to give to man that which he stands in need of. In order for us to be recipients of God's grace, we must acknowledge that we are in need of His grace. In other words, as long as we feel that we can save ourselves, we shut ourselves off from the grace of God. As long as we do not recognize ourselves as sinners, we will not see our need of His grace. Later on in Romans, Paul shows us that all men are sinners and all stand in need of God's grace. If we take the position that we are worthy of God's grace, we will find that we are not. If any one of us should come before God and say, "I have lived a good life, Lord, and have a good character, and would therefore like to have your all-sufficient grace," it would be refused us. God cannot shower His grace on self-sufficient persons. On the other hand, when we stand before God acknowledging that we are sinners and justly condemned and feeling our great need, then God's grace will be released to supply that need. This is what God is telling us through Paul. Jesus Christ came in grace to save condemned sinners. He loved us while we were sinners and died for us while we were His enemies. We see then how necessary it was that Jesus become man in order to save us. And having seen that, let us obey the exhortation which says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ." Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. This is what he did in order to save us from our sins. But this is not all that he accomplished in our behalf. The next verses in this passage show what happened to him because of his work of salvation, and indicate what more he has done for us. The words are, "Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, and things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." Verses 9 through 11. Eventually, we too shall be exalted, for we are made heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 8, verse 17. Thank you for watching. We'll pick it up again next time, right here where we left off in segment number 2. And since he bids me